I was asked to talk about Adventist identity. Now, all of you have heard the name of Edward Snowden. It's an American guy who worked for NSA, National Security Agency. And then last May, he fled to Hong Kong and released some documents that the US and the UK government are not too happy about. I suspect nobody is going to accuse me of being Edward Snowden if I tell you that Adventist Church goes through a crisis of identity. I hope I did not betray any company secret. But that's the reality. If you have been in the church for more than 2 weeks, you must be aware of that. Okay, my presentation this afternoon will have three parts. The first, you're not going to understand what Adventism represents, what Adventism stands for, unless you understand the world in which Adventism was born. I'm sorry, it's a history of ideas, and I understand not everybody at school liked history, so you have an official permission to take a short nap after the lunch. History is not one of your domains. Then we are going to look at, I will wake you up, and we are going to look at what was the New Testament understanding of identity. We have heard people say, oh, we have lost our identity because people use drums in the church. Excuse me, the identity of the church is not based on what musical instrument you use at worship. They are singing from a different hymnal now. Okay, so we lost our identity. Not the new Advent hymnal, which actually is old Advent hymnal. So how does the New Testament understand identity? We'll have a look at that. And then I will look at what identity meant for Adventism throughout our history. And then I will ask, so what are the consequences for overcoming the crisis of identity, as the title of the presentation is. What are the consequences for us? All right, so if you don't like, oh, one more thing. As I said, we are going through a crisis of identity as the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Until 1964, we could always say, just as Noah preached the flood, and then it happened after 120 years. We are going to preach the soon coming of Jesus, and then it's going to happen. But when nothing happened after 120 years, Adventism entered a crisis of identity. Why are we here? It used to be clear. Now, after 170 years, do you realize that this October it will be 170 years since the Great Disappointment? The question is, how long can you cry wolf, wolf, and still be taken seriously? And so, Adventism worked with a shortness of time mentality. Victor mentioned this morning that, you know, 3,000 Adventists in the UK did amazing. The spread of their interest on what they managed, to have a school, to have a sanitarium, to have a health factory, a publishing house, a Dorcas, you know, kind of address society. Because the mentality of, let us pull our sleeves, Jesus is coming the day after tomorrow. If we don't do it, who else will do it for the Lord? We are the only ones who are doing it anyway. Now you realize, probably God has more people than just the little flock. Of course, in Adventism, there are many proposals on the table how to solve the current crisis. The problem is that as a result of that, Adventism is more fragmented today than ever, any time in its history. And we'll deal with that. So, when we talk about the crisis of identity, it's nothing new under the sun. It's a widespread contemporary issue. You have a tension between the young and the old, the generation gap. The younger generation sees things differently than the older used to see it. You have the whole nations going through a crisis of identity. Does Georgia belong into NATO? Should Ukraine be part of the European Union? Is it better to have a euro or a national currency? First of January this year, Latvia became the state number 18 using the euro currency. I have read some interviews with some people who feel, our currency was the third strongest in the world, and we gave it up for uncertain euro. Haven't we lost something of our national identity? And don't even mention euro in Britain. Would something be lost of a national identity? And of course, the church organizations go through crisis of identity. Do you know what is the average age of the governing body of Jehovah's Witnesses in Brooklyn, New York? 81 years. There are going to be some serious changes in 10 years. Not so long ago, I was at Oxford Street at the Salvation Army Center there. Walked through and watched some of the pictures on the walls. You think that it's difficult, Nathan, to convince young people to embrace Adventism? Imagine that you're a Salvation Army challenge. Try to convince young people today that to rescue the fallen women, you should play in a brass music band at the street corner. That's the way how you serve Jesus. That's a crisis of identity. The whole people groups, Darfur, South Ossetia, Nagorno-Karabakh, became household names because a large group of people are displaced and go through a crisis of identity. Syria, nowadays, you heard the millions of people that have been displaced. So we are not alone. We are no exception. If we go through a crisis of identity, it's something that's very common in our world. I have a picture in my camera of the Ibis Hotel near Heathrow, and there is a huge billboard in front of the hotel. We are reinventing ourselves for the sake of our customers. I was with Ian Sweeney on the going on the bus that takes us from the parking lot to the airport the other day, and I said to him, we should have something like this at the union. We are reinventing ourselves for the sake of our customers. If they need to do it in order to survive, do you think the church doesn't need to do that? So, and here comes the time when if you are not into the world of ideas, you can have a short nap, and I will wake you up a little bit later. You are not going to understand what Adventism is all about unless you understand the world into which Adventism was born. So, Adventism starts in a period when European thinking comes the era of enlightenment. And that's in 18th century, between 1700 and 1750, when people come up with a new way of thinking, new way of approaching reality. And they say that tradition or authority are no longer an acceptable source of the answers. Before enlightenment, if a priest said something, if a teacher said something, that was the truth. That would rule the day. And if the Pope pronounced something, it was infallible. All right? And now people say, not anymore. We are going to apply reason, logic, to everything. And whatever is not reasonable, rational, logical, will not stand. And of course, they have this very naive idea that if everybody is strictly logical, all will arrive at the same conclusions. Now, okay, if you are living 18th century, you are excused for thinking so. After 20th century and understanding presuppositions and filters, how we perceive reality, we know better. But they believe that you can come up with an objective understanding, an objective conclusion that is the same for everybody. You will still find this in Adventism very strong, that if two people read the same text, they will come up with the same understanding. It's the vestiges of that thinking. Now, this created a crisis of identity. because the medieval understanding of world is shaken. Before enlightenment, everything was clear. God is up there. If we are good, he rewards us. If we are bad, he punishes us. But the identity was clear. And that comes the enlightenment and throws it into disarray. Things are not that simple. And what caused the change in thinking, in the mentality, more than anything else, was this faithful event on Saturday morning, 1st of November, 1755, when at 9:40 a.m. an earthquake struck the capital of Portugal, Lisbon. Now, what's so significant about this earthquake? About, historians say that about 275,000 people lived in Lisbon in those days. And out of them, about 60 to 90,000 people died. Now, we have in history earthquakes in which 600,000 people died. Actually, there was an earthquake in China where 900,000 people died. What made this event so significant?
Everybody was in church.
And if you come from a Catholic country, because Portugal is a Catholic country, you will understand that what has made this so significant is that it happened on 1st of November, which in all Catholic countries is an All Saints' Day. In other words, everybody at 9:40 a.m. is either going home from the church, because they attended the first Mass, or they are in the church, or they are going to the church to catch the second Mass. And so the result was that most of these people who died in Lisbon's earthquake died in cathedrals. Because if you are in a cathedral during an earthquake, a Gothic cathedral is not a good place to be when the earthquake strikes. And the historians say that the brothers on the shore are intact. If God is punishing sinners, he certainly didn't know where the sinners are. Where? And the world was never the same again. After Lisbon, people are no longer going to believe that earthquakes are a punishment from an angry God. The way they think is going to change. And so in science, you start with seismology, and from now on, they come up with a new interpretation. Earthquakes are the results of tectonics, the plates of the crust moving against each other. And in theology, you start with deism, which means, or it says, God is the creator who started this world, created it like a watchmaker, wound the clock, but he is not running it. He is not interfering with the way it's run. Are we clear on this so far? Mm-hmm. Enlightenment is a rethinking of medieval European mindset. Okay. Then comes an ingenious farmer, a Baptist farmer whose name is William Miller. And during his growing up years, he lost his faith because he became a deist. He does not believe that God interferes in the running of everyday life. But then he goes, so he doesn't believe that God is involved in running this world. But then he goes into the war, and the Americans are fighting the British. People in those days believe that now science, technology will rule the mankind, and the era of discoveries will improve our lives, and the golden age of humanity will start. Now he goes into this war against the British, and somebody said that in the trenches there are no atheists. And he can see that some of his colleagues are praying so that they survive in this war. And of course, some of them died, and some of them survived. And that created some problem for him, because God is not supposed to answer the prayers. He's supposed to be distant. And then comes this famous Battle of Plattsburgh in 1814, where a smaller army of Americans defeated a larger army of British An ill-equipped American army defeated well-equipped British army. And William Miller cannot understand how this has happened. Why it happened that we defeated the British? And he comes to a only possible conclusion. God must have wanted so. Now, this creates for him a crisis of identity, crisis of faith, because according to his deism, God is not supposed to interfere with the affairs of humanity. So when he comes back home from that war, he needs to rethink his approach. He starts reading the Bible, and of course, there he discovers that actually the Bible says that there is not going to be a golden era, 1,000 years of peace and joy and happiness and discoveries, that God will come after the millennialism. In 19th century America, all conservative Christians are post-millennialists. They believe that after the golden age, golden era, will Jesus come. And Miller says, no. Actually, the Bible says that Jesus is going to come first, and then the millennium starts. Now, you can think whatever you want about Miller, but he was a genius. He managed to change the way people think. Today, there are no post-millennialists in Christianity. People are either pre-millennialists or un-millennialists, so they don't believe in millennium, but nobody is post-millennial anymore. And the rest is history. He reads the Bible, discovers that Jesus is going to come, it's going to be a cataclysmic event. He doesn't want to share it, but then he makes the promise. And the nephew, that if somebody invites him, he's going to, willing to speak about it. And before he gets up from his knees, his nephew appears and says, "Uncle, my dad is asking if you could preach the sermon next Sunday." And for the next, that was 1831, and for the next 13 years, Millerism will have no crisis of identity. There will be very clear cut. Why are we here? Why? To preach the soon coming of Jesus. Jesus is going to come soon to this planet. The other churches, post-millennial churches, don't appreciate it, so they get kicked out, mostly. You need to understand one thing. America today has over 300 million people. America in those days had 37 million people. Historians say that about 250,000 people were part of the Millerite movement. So Millerism was something that was on the first front pages of the newspapers. This was the evening news item about Miller and his preaching. So everybody knows about this. And they lived happily ever after. Until that Wednesday, that Tuesday midnight, when it turned to Wednesday, 23rd of October, 1844, when Millerism is thrown into great crisis of identity. Why? To use the words of Ellen White, and we cried and cried and cried, because Jesus did not come. And they go through a great crisis of identity. Great disappointment, as they call it. Was it all in vain? Was it all a mistake? What happened? Why are we here? Can the Bible be trusted? And once again, they are thrown into a crisis of identity. And out of this great disappointment, out of this rethinking, Seventh-day Adventism is born. So, can you see? What are we trying to say? Adventism is a rethinking of Millerism. Millerism is a rethinking of deism. And deism is a rethinking of enlightenment. And enlightenment is a rethinking of medieval Christianity. So Adventism is born into this period of rethinking, where in the period of 100 years, there's this constant rethinking that what was true for more than 1,000 years in the European realm suddenly is not true anymore. Enlightenment it into disarray. What do you do with this in theological terms? Deism comes. How do you deal with that when the reality points that, yes, God does answer prayer. Yes, there are events which are very difficult to explain with naturalistic causes. So Millerism, rethinking of deism. Deism is a rethinking of enlightenment. And when Millerism goes through a tremendous crisis of identity, Adventism is born as a rethinking of Millerism. So Adventism has written in its birth certificate, we are a rethinking movement. It starts as a rethinking movement. In a period where if people ate eggs and ham for breakfast, no problem. For centuries, we are now going to eat cornflakes. Kellogg says we need to put yogurt from the top and yogurt from the bottom. Because you need to be clean. If you ate white bread for centuries, now you are going to eat whole wheat bread, dry bread. You are going to use water outside, inside. If they kept Sunday for 2,000 years, who cares? For next week, we are keeping Saturday. So it's part of this rethinking mentality. A few years back, I was in Battle Creek for a funeral. Ken Wilson, remember Kelly Wilson from New World, a student. When her father died, they asked me to conduct the funeral for them. And so I had one free afternoon in Battle Creek, and I went to see the village. And I discovered that Uriah Smith had a patent for an artificial leg. These guys were rethinking not only a realm of theology, God was rethinking, as a polio victim, what could help other victims like me? They came up with an artificial leg. So it's a rethinking mentality. Now here's the thing. Every rethinking moves you forward. Brings something new. Something positive. And every rethinking creates some mess. Some confusion. Why? Because you don't get it perfectly. There is no such thing as perfect understanding. And so, Miller's rethinking caused a crisis of faith for 250,000 people. And they said, never again we are going to study prophecies and apocalyptic literature. Never again. That's why this reluctance in conservative evangelical Christianity about studying apocalyptic prophecies. We got our fingers burnt. Don't try that on us again. Because every rethinking brings something positive and something negative. Now, to deal with the negative, you need another rethinking. And that rethinking will bring something positive and something negative. The idea that now, I should have put this slide on here. I have a slide from the Sabbath school, children's Sabbath school, where the teaching, there is a big map of different Christian denominations, you know, how it started the early church, and then the teacher points to one corner, and here we appeared and got it right. And the little kid says, isn't Jesus happy to have us? Jesus must be happy that he has got us. There's no such thing as perfect rethinking. With our limited capacity. So you always discover something, and there is always a little devil in the detail. There's something that you didn't get right, and there's always space for more rethinking. So, here's the bottom line. Adventism was born as a rethinking movement. And my basic thesis will be, as long as it remains a rethinking movement, it has a future. As long as it goes into trying to emulate established churches, we will know what will be the outcome. Empty cathedrals, full cemeteries. Somebody else walked that route before us. All right, so turn to the person next to you and choose one question out of three. You live in 2013. What are the events? What are the books that you read recently? What are the trends in music, in fashion. In technology. Steve Jobs comes back as a CEO, temporary CEO of Apple, and says, Apple is a great company. The problem is that we produce, and you know, he had very, very clear, either something was excellent or it was S-H-I-T. And it needs to change. People had no idea they need an iPad. He convinced them that you should have one. So what are the trends that create a crisis of identity? Because they are identity. As you mentioned, somebody somewhere in the church should read those books of the clever three guys, the new atheists who came with new challenges with Christianity. Not everybody in the church should read it, but somebody somewhere should read it and come up with good answers. Do you think that if Adventism started in Brazil, we would have the same type of Adventism? Certainly football would not be mentioned in the church manual as something that we frown upon. If we originated from Brazil. If Adventism started in Philippines, do you think we would have the same Adventism today as we have? Or in a local church, you know, if you come from a small church somewhere, 40 members, and you had an elder who was ruling there with an iron fist for the last 35 years. Don't you think that the type of Adventism you have in that local church is not influenced by that historical context in which it functions? So, turn to the person next to you and choose one. And see how we are part of the crisis of identity. Have you heard about Harald Camping? He just died in December. Harald Camping died in December. He was the guy who predicted that Jesus will come on 23rd of May 2011. How do you preach the soonness of coming after Harald Camping?
He wasn't far
off
the mark.
I mean?
He wasn't far off the mark for himself. If he died not too long after, then for him. Do you see what I mean?
I mean, no. It was on billboard, it was on the news everywhere. Yeah. Have you seen the jokes, how people left the shirt and the trainers on the sidewalk? He said, secret rapture, I was here, just I'm gone. When it didn't happen, he said, oh, he came spiritually, but in October that year, he will come for sure with the judgment that will destroy the world. How do you preach these things after Harald Camping? It creates a crisis of identity. You have to preach the second coming and you may. You can't do it the same, otherwise you are laughing some sort. All right, so can you see how understanding the environment, the milieu of Adventism is going to be useful to understand why are we going through this crisis of identity? And how that is part of the world in which we live, and unless we find a way to deal with it, we are answering questions that nobody's asking. Or repeating a narrative which is refuted by the latest evidence. All right, so we wake those who have the permission to sleep, and let's go to the New Testament. Listen to this, Matthew 16. And remember, Matthew is the evangelist that writes to the Jews. He wants to show that Jesus is a king, he's a new Moses. One day Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi. Do you understand? What? Do you know where is Caesarea Philippi?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
It's up north. Yes. It's up north. outside of Galilean territory. Caesarea Philippi, it's a famous pilgrim place. There are many temples there. People come there to worship different gods. The most famous is goat god Pan, P-A-N. Have you heard about panic attacks?
Yes.
So that comes panacea, That comes from that. There is a cleft in the rock, a cliff, opening in the cliff, which is called the Gates of Hades. And people believe that through that opening, through that cleft, demons go out into the world. It's a big pilgrim place, and of course, to worship this goat god, they have immoral orgies. No Jewish rabbi would go there. And one day, Jesus takes his disciples. Now, forget the medieval pictures of disciples, where there are 50s plus guys. These are all young lads. John is the youngest, about 17. They are all early 20s, late teens, early 20s. And he takes them there, takes them out of the Galilean village where they lived, into this place of pilgrimage where people come from all over the world. You need to get a new perspective. You need to think outside of the box. Now, try to imagine how they nudge one another, say, I'm curious how he's going to explain this to my parents when they found out that we went to Caesarea Philippi. But Jesus understands we need to do some R&D, research and development. We need to get a different picture. And there he asks his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they say, oh, this is easy. It's just a staff meeting in order to appraise the progress of the work. And so they start reporting. Some say John the Baptist, was resurrected. Some others say Elijah, who came back from heaven. Some others Jeremiah, who was resurrected. Or the prophet that Moses prophesied in Deuteronomy 18 that is supposed to come at the end of ages. Nothing that threatening. Just they give descriptive answers. A Gallup poll of what's going on around. And then Jesus drops the question, what about you? What do you say? Where do you stand, guys? Who do you say I am? Now, this is a very interesting question. You know why? Because Jesus did not ask about his teachings. So what do people say about my teaching? Do they like my parables? There's a retired professor at Andrews University, Robert Johnston, New Testament professor. Some years back he wrote a book, They Also Spoke in Parables. In that book he compares the parables of first century Jewish rabbis with the parables of Jesus. They also spoke in parables. But Jesus didn't ask, so, do people like my parables? Do they think they are better than the parables the rabbi says? Remember Jesus said once a parable, there was a man who had a vineyard and he came out to the market at 6 a.m. and hired people to go and work there for 12 hours. And in that society, one denarius was a wage for 12 hours of hard manual labor. And then he went out at 9, at 12, at 3, at 5. And then starting from the end, he paid one denarius to all of them. The rabbis have a parable, very similar to that, but in that parable, those who came at 5 did as much work as those who came at 6 in the morning. But Jesus does not indicate any of that. So in the parable of the rabbis, those who got denarius, they actually deserved it because they did the same amount of work as those who came in the morning. They were just slow and inefficient, while those who came late were fast and efficient. And so they deserved what they got. And Jesus flies against that notion that people get what they deserve. But he didn't ask about his parables. He asked, who do people say I am? And of course, Peter answered, you are the Christ, you are Christos, you are the Mashiach, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He identifies Jesus in terms of his mission and in terms of his person, who Christ is. And Jesus responds, blessed you are, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood. You didn't get it from human sources, but from my Father in heaven. I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. You are Petros, and on this Petra I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. Do you understand what he's saying? In Caesarea Philippi, he's telling these Jewish fishermen boys, guys, and what we are doing is going to be more famous than what you see over here around. Imagine how they looked. What? Sure enough. Today, more than 2.4 billion people are followers of Jesus. And unless you are what Germans call a Fachidiot, a specialist in the ancient religions, you have no idea what is Caesarea Philippi and the Pan Goat God, what they did there. But for those Galilean guys, that must have been something. He gives them a revelation they could not learn in the Galilean village. You need to come here to this place and see that what I am doing when I come to you is going to change the world. It's going to turn the world upside down. Why? Because of who Jesus is. The identity in the New Testament is not based on what Jesus does, on the teachings of Jesus, but on the person of Jesus. The teachings of Jesus are important, but they're important because of who Jesus is. So, the most crucial question of Christianity is, who is Jesus? To be a Marxist, you have to believe that the explanation of Karl Marx about what moves the history forward, his philosophy of history, is the true interpretation of history. Then you are a Marxist. But to be a Christian, it's not enough to believe the teachings of Jesus. To be a Muslim, you have to believe that there is one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his true prophet. But to be a Christian is not enough to believe that there is one God, and Jesus' Son, Jesus Christ, is his only begotten Son. That's not Christianity. Christianity has to do with who is Jesus. Finding the right relationship with the person of Jesus. As you know, I used to teach for 7-8 years at Newport College. I still have some friends there. If I was crazy and I would come back there and say, so what do people say about me? Do they laugh about my jokes? Do they think I am a good teacher? They'd say, I know what's going on here. Little bit megalomania. But Jesus doesn't ask, what do people say about my teachings? He asks, what do people say about me? Who am I? Because the essence of Christianity is, who is Jesus? To find the answer to the question, who is Jesus? To have a relationship, a personal relationship with the person of Jesus. So, let me put it this way. The person of Jesus precedes the doctrines of Jesus. Now notice I chose my words very carefully. I did not say that the person of Jesus is more important with the doctrines of Jesus. Because if I said that, some of you might imply, aha, that means that the doctrines of Jesus are not important. And I didn't say that. What I said is that the doctrines of Jesus are important because of who Jesus is. But the person of Jesus precedes the doctrine of Jesus. And so in the New Testament, the identity is based on the person, and the person of Jesus. He becomes the cornerstone which holds the whole building together. So, in that sense, you can say that Christianity is based on Jesus. Christianity equals Jesus. Okay, and from there, two small steps. If Adventism is part of Christianity, then identity in Adventism must be based on
Jesus.
If not, then you are just a cult. If you want to be a Christian church, your identity must be based not on the drums, not what kind of musical instrument you use in your church, not what kind of hymnal are you singing, or if you are singing from the baseball, from the screen. No. They lost their identity, now they are singing from the screen. Guys, when was the identity based on what kind of hymn do you use on Sabbath or Sunday morning? The identity in Christianity based on Jesus. And of course, how do you understand verse 18? And you are Petros, and on this Petra I will build my church. Depends what is your religious affiliation. If you are from certain neck of the woods, you will say that by saying this, Jesus pronounced Peter the first pope, and all the bishops of Rome share the same power, and so the church is based on here. The interesting thing is that if you look at that, Jesus says, "You are blessed, Simon, son of Jonah, because of this God's revelation, you become Petros, and I will build my church on Petra. You'll become a small stone, but my church is built on something bigger than that." Notice Simon on his own is just who he is, Mr. Anonymous. But it's son of John, in English would be Johnson, or Icelandic, somebody say amen. So Johnson plus Christ equals rock. And if you go into 1 Peter 2, you know what's interesting? That Peter says there, actually there's nothing that special about me. Anybody who has this relationship, who understands this revelation, who God is, becomes a living stone that God is using to build his temple. So any one of us with Christ, relationship with Christ, and accepting that revelation, who Christ is, becomes a building stone. And all of us together, this is very westernized, me and my sweet Jesus. Bible doesn't know much about it. It's always communal thinking. We didn't get into that this morning. We were so eager to share your insights that we didn't get into the health as a community aspect. That health is not only an individual, okay. Be careful how you eat. No, that's the Adventist version of it. Just make sure you don't smoke, don't drink, and eat healthily, and that's it. No, health is also a community matter. Do we care about the community? Do we have the message? I don't condemn you. God is not into condemnation business, even when you brought it on yourself, as the guy in Mark 2. Are we known as people? Imagine what would happen if 34,000 Adventists on British Isles would create a community where we are not meant to condemn. Their doors are always open. Even if you have been smoking all your life and brought this lung cancer on you, we still have a message for you. God is not in condemnation business. Romans 8. God condemns nobody. Let me put my arms around you. Your sins are forgiven. Would you like to live differently from tomorrow? Imagine what a different world it would be. So all of us, with Christ, become the living stones, become the body of Christ, the community of believers. And Acts 2:46 says, in Eugene Peterson translation, the message, "And people liked what they saw." In your Bible it says, "And they had favor with all people." Eugene Peterson translates, and people like it will be so. When church becomes the multicultural community, people like it will be so. They were not sure about the doctrines. So we Jews never believe these things, but they liked what they saw. Because suddenly there was a community where people were equal, where women were accepted, where children were important. They are not going to vote for you in the next election. That's what impressed the rich young ruler. How Jesus treated the children. The next story is, he came to him and said, "Man, sir, you've got something to offer." He was a ruler, he knew children are not important for the rulers. They don't vote for you in the next election. But how he answered the Pharisees and the Sadducees, how he treated children, this guy has something to offer. People like what they saw, a different type of community. Why did he brought them out of Egypt? So that he will have a different type of community. Anti-kingdom. Not the pyramid of Egypt. New type of God's new society, to use John Stott's words. All right, are we clear on the identity in the New Testament? What is the identity in the New Testament based on?
Jesus.
My personal Jesus. Jesus Christ. Personal relationship with him. When things don't go the way the disciples wanted, they joined this rabbi because they had great expectations. We are going to be the ministers. And he does not perform what they do. They get frustrated, they get disappointed. There are 6 to 9 months before the Passover, before the Easter in Caesarea Philippi. When Jesus drops this and that, he says, "So, what do you say?" And Peter says, "You are God, even when you don't work the way I expect you to work. When things don't turn out the way I want you to act, you are still God. You are still who you are." And Jesus says, on this understanding that God is still God, even when he doesn't answer my prayers the way I prayed for, I'm still going to stick with you because of who you are. I can build a new type of community around this. Clear? So, the role of the doctrine is to deepen my relationship with Jesus. Why do we have doctrines? Are doctrines important? Yes. But to make my relationship with Jesus practical, livable. If you believe in everlasting or a burning hell, it's very difficult for you to believe that God is love. Now, some have managed that mental gymnastics. It's much easier if you believe that no, God is not going to burn people in hell for eternity. For an amount of sin that you committed in the short period of life. Limited period of time, unlimited punishment. The role of doctrines is to make me more loving, more gracious, more tolerant person. If you are not more loving, more gracious, and more tolerant, what's the point of the doctrines? I would say to help with your doctrine. What's the point? So the doctrines are important. False doctrines devalue your relationship with Jesus. But remember, there is not going to be a test at the heavenly gate. When you come there, enter your username and your password. It's not going to be a test on doctrines. You see, it's once again this post-enlightenment mentality that plays on our minds. So, if you believe that Earth is flat like a pancake, you're a fool forgotten here by unenlightened eras. But if you say, oh, world is like a football flying in the middle of nowhere, you give the right answer. And so, of course, we have this idea that you come to the heavenly gate and there is enter your username, and the username is the answer to the question, which day does God expect us to keep? Okay, I know the answer. And the password is the answer to the question, in which year did the investigative judgment start? But this is the post-enlightenment thinking, that if you have the scientific, if you have the right answer, you've got it. Even in education nowadays, we move away from that because nowadays people with a smartphone can find it on the internet. quickly. Education is different than giving the right answer to the kids, because now everybody can find it. Needs to be something else. So, are the doctrines important?
Yes.
Of course they are, but they are not the goal. It's not going to be the test on doctrines before you enter the heavenly gates. On the contrary, the purpose of the millennium is to have a makeup class on doctrines and to teach people actually, even with all the tools off, and teach you how things are. So, choose one question. Have you heard about Martin Doppelmayr? He's a director who filmed this movie, Adventists. You watch that movie and you think that all Adventists are just medical doctors and nurses and college professors. But he's the guy who is fascinated that there is a church that believes in six-day creation of all things in this world, yet they are so scientific with their approach to health. They are not some kind of crazy sectarians, as their doctrines might suggest, but they've got the protein accelerator to treat the cancer, and he is very fascinated by that, because for him, the doctrine creates that you live 7 years extra. Now, of course, many Adventists say you don't live longer, it just seems longer. How does the doctrine fulfill its role? Have you noticed that the statement from Dallas, 1980, doesn't say that Jesus in 1844 went into the second apartment of the heavenly sanctuary? The statement from Dallas that we have now says that Jesus started a new phase, second phase of his ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. So we have moved away from the thinking, you know, there are two rooms in heaven. Because that's very, very haptic. You know, that's very earthly thinking, projecting from earthly sanctuary to the heavenly sanctuary. What's the purpose of the doctrine? Are there any benefits, advantages of right doctrine? Certainly you live longer. But how do you feel that, those 7 extra years? If you fill it with rubbish, what's the point? What do you think about the thesis that Adventism equals Jesus? Is this the best news that needs to be spread far, wide, and loudly? Or hopefully, I hope nobody tells our young people, because they might start behaving differently. Is it the best news or is it a threat? If the essence or identity of Adventism is in Jesus, how does it influence the way you teach the statement that we used to make sure that everybody understands they are dead, they are there? But, okay, that's not the most important thing. Probably the most important thing is, Paul says in Colossians, your life is hidden with Christ. My mom just died in November, 9th of November. For the last 3 years, she had Alzheimer's disease. And it was very sad to see how we lost her before we lost her. It was not the same person. How the bulbs went out one by one. And that God has saved you on his USB stick and is going to recreate you in your best. Because to recreate what was there in November was not the same person. It's the essence of Sabbath. Do you know that before Bakayoko wrote his From Human, Divine Rest for Human Restlessness, except for Sakai Kubo's God Meets Man, we did not produce a book on theology of Sabbath. We always just insisted that Sabbath is the seventh day. But we didn't say, okay, so what? which is insisting that people keep the right day. Of course, you read on the internet about the place in Pacific where they changed the dateline and now they are keeping the wrong day. And some Adventists get really upset and agitated about that because, well, the whole world is running into a catastrophe because they are keeping the wrong day. What's the essence of that? If there is no person there. Okay. Have 5 minutes. Have a go. Otherwise, you will fall asleep. In the historical section, I try to show you that Adventism is a rethinking of Millerism. Millerism is a rethinking of deism. And deism is a rethinking of Enlightenment. And Enlightenment is a rethinking of medieval philosophy, medieval European thought, Catholic Europe. So Adventism is born as a rethinking movement, it's written in birth certificate. We are a rethinking movement. Because it was born in this era where they were rethinking their food, their religion, slavery, all other aspects of the functioning of the society. Every rethinking brings something positive and creates some mess. To deal with the negative, you have to do another rethinking. There is no other way, just do another rethinking. Because there is no perfect understanding. So to sort out the confusion, another rethinking is needed. And so Adventism is born as a rethinking movement which says, we are willing to change. You want to go into traditional church, singing traditional churches in a traditional environment? No. The world is your oyster. Why did you want to be a part of a rethinking movement? You always had a group of people who were kicking the majority in the...
You call it?
Achilles.
Ankle.
Ankle. The ankle said, guys, don't forget this. And what about this? How can you say we are God's people if you mistreat the orphan and the widow? Guys, don't forget about that. And always the people were bringing the community back to rethinking and seeing the different aspects of the picture. All right. I said, Adventism was born in 1844 as a rethinking of Millerism, as a post-great disappointment experience. So if that is true, where was God in it? And of course the idea was, sure, Daniel 8:14 did not refer to the earth, the sanctuary, something else, etc., etc. And they come up with a complete rethinking. They discover the Sabbath, the second coming, the sanctuary, the healthful living, the sleep soul, etc. A new way of understanding and expressing Christianity in the context of 19th century. Jesus is going to come soon. What is driving the system? What is driving the thinking? The soon coming of Jesus. Eschatology means the doctrine of the last things. The soon coming of Jesus. Let us pull our sleeves, our socks, and let's get moving. Let's get things done. Because the judgment will depend on how we preached, lived these testing truths that nobody else is preaching and doing. And so they get out into the world. 1874. The first missionary will go where? To the land of John Calvin, because the gospel was never preached there. Okay. And White says, we are sending you our best. Why? Because we have these testing truths that we have discovered that need to be spread. And for 40 years, they are doing their best to spread this around the world. Until that end of October, early November time when they all meet in Minneapolis, yeah, Minnesota for another GC session to sort out two questions. First, who are the three horns that were uprooted by the little horn in Daniel 7? And second, which law is the Apostle Paul talking about in the gospel, in the letter, epistle to Galatians, when he says that the law was added because of transgression? But they made a mistake, so to say, because they asked for the devotionals to be taken by someone who was young and educated and from California. And every time you ask in the church people to do something which are young and educated and from the wrong part of the world, something is going to happen. Wagner and Jones are preaching these devotional messages, and they start preaching about righteousness by faith. Wagner even tells the joke, saying that a man comes to the heavenly gate and the voice is heard, "So what have you done to be here?" And the answer is, "I have kept all the commandments." And the voice says, "Okay, in that case, welcome here. We have no one like that here yet." New understanding dawns on them that you are not going to pass the bar of the investigative judgment. You are not going to enter heaven on the basis of your performance when you're testing truth, but on the basis of the finished work of Christ on the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. And this creates a crisis of identity in Adventism. And a big uproar starts at the very meeting when people say, "What is this new teaching? It's undermining the old landmarks. This is not what Adventism is all about. We are supposed to preach the law, the third angel's message." But then the prophetess, the old little lady, takes side of the young guys and says, "We have been preaching the law so long as we have become dry as the hills of Gilboa. Let the law take care of itself." And she has something to say to them as well. As a good Methodist, she says, "You know, remember, they are discussing the three horns." And she says, "There are too many horns sticking out here. What we need is more Jesus." Mm-hmm. And you know what happens? Adventism goes through a crisis of identity. And when she says, "Oh, there have been a lot of this nonsense about old landmarks being forsaken," the three angels' messages are righteousness by faith in verity. He said, "Okay, this is what we are supposed to preach." A change, a rethinking happens in Adventism. And Adventism does a rethinking in 1888. Minneapolis is a rethinking period for Adventism. And as a rethinking movement, we did it really well. So, before, the Adventist pastors, they were fighting the pastors of other denominations because you didn't have, you know, all this TV serial shows, you know. So people come for a discussion between the Adventist pastor and the other clergyman, discussing which day is the biblical Sabbath, what happens when you die. But in Minneapolis, they turn the swords against one another and start bringing one another down. And that's when Ellen White said, "What we need is more Jesus." And they realize salvation is not based on what we do, on our testing truth. You are not going to pass the bar of the judgment based on your performance. It's based on the finished work of Christ. Now, I'm sorry to say that Minneapolis still has not arrived into some congregations, but this is what happened in 1888. A shift in Adventism. Why? Because 44 years later, Adventism still is a rethinking movement. And did the rethinking, and did it well. And a new period starts in Adventism, where the driving force will not be so much the shortness of time, will be the right soteriology, the right understanding. How are we saved? And 2 years later, Ellen White is going to publish the book Desire of Ages, in which she says on page 530 that in Christ there was life unborrowed, underived, original, unborrowed, underived, and says that Jesus is God from eternity. He's not a created being, he's God from eternity. In 1928, Leroy Edwin Froome published the book The Coming of a Comforter, in which he says the Holy Spirit is not a power, he's a person. Because for the right understanding of salvation, you need to have the right understanding of who is the Savior. What is the role of the Holy Spirit in the process of salvation? And a rethinking takes place in Adventism. That this group, ragtag group of different, from different groups before, suddenly realizes our soteriology needs to be different than the soteriology of Jehovah's Witnesses. If we are a Christian Protestant church, and we don't believe in Jesus as a created being, we believe that Jesus is the second person of Trinity. And the Holy Spirit is not power, he's the third person of Trinity. As Knight would say, they discovered that there was something that the early Christians also got right. There is something they can learn from the other. All right, and then we come to 1956, when a Pennsylvania Conference president, Thomas Unruh, is traveling home in his car from a preaching appointment, and he listens on his radio, car radio, to preaching of Donald Barnhouse on the letter to Romans. And his heart is strangely warmed as he listens, and he comes home and writes a letter. Dear Dr. Barnhouse, the other day I was listening to your sermons on the book of Romans, and I was very blessed by your sermon. And I thank God for people like you who preach the message of righteousness by faith with such clarity. God bless your ministry. Signed, Thomas Unruh, Pennsylvania Conference President, Seventh-day Adventist Church. And back comes the letter. Dear Brother Unruh, I am very surprised that you liked my sermons on the book of Romans about righteousness by faith, because we know that Adventists don't believe in righteousness by faith. So Thomas Unruh writes back and says, oh, this is a big misunderstanding. Of course we believe in righteousness by faith. We are Protestants. And Donald Barnhouse writes back and says, no. When I was growing up in Baltimore, we had Adventist kids playing with us, and they knew nothing about righteousness by faith. They were legalists. And because Pennsylvania is not far from Washington, D.C., Thomas Unruh takes this correspondence and brings it to Tacoma Park, to the G.C. headquarters. We have been around for 100 years as Seventh-day Adventist Church, and people, the society, has no clue what we believe. They think we are some kind of a sect. They have no idea that we are a Protestant church that believes in righteousness by faith. At that time, Zondervan, which is a famous evangelical publishing house, asked Walter Martin to write a book on American sects. And he has commissioned an artist to create the cover for the book. And the artist painted a big octopus with 8 tentacles. And one tentacle was written Christian Science. The other was Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventists. And because Walter Martin is a researcher, he goes about writing the book about American sects by creating a set of questions that he wants to ask these people and to talk to them. So he goes to Boston, the headquarters of the Christian Science. You know, these are the people who believe that Mary Eddy Baker was a prophetess, and that if you take medicine, you are dishonoring God, because you should pray and not take any medicine. And so he knocks on their door and says, I'm here writing a book about American sects. I have a few questions that I would like to ask you. And they slam the door into his face. So he goes to Brooklyn, New York, and talks to Jehovah's Witnesses and says, I am writing a book on American sects, and I would like to disclose to American people what you believe. Here are my questions. And they slam the door into his face. They are not going to talk to you. And so he comes to Tacoma Park, where the GC headquarters was in those days, and says, I am writing a book on American sects, and I have a few questions that I would like to ask you. And because Unruh brought this correspondence to the GC, and because you have a constellation of open mind, they open the door and say, "What are your questions?" And so they start the discussions. In the process, Walter Martin becomes sick, and they say, brethren say to him, "Oh, do you go somewhere? We have an Adventist, Washington Adventist hospital here." No, a few, 1-2 miles from the Tacoma Park headquarters, they're on the campus of CUC or Washington Adventist University nowadays, you go there. And so he's treated there, and the nurses are so nice and say, "Dr. Martin, what can we do for you? Can we pray for you?" And he says, "I can see that you are genuine Christians. I am going to take you out of my book. I'm still going to write a book about you." And sure enough, in 1961, he wrote the book, The Truth About Seventh-day Adventism. But he said, "I'm going to take you out of the book because I can see that you are genuine Christians." And then in 1958, Donald Barnhouse took part in these discussions, and he was also editor of magazine Eternity, wrote an article in that magazine. "We had discussions with Seventh-day Adventists, and I have to say, we have been wrong. They are genuine Christians and should be accepted as such." You know what was the price he paid? 30% of his subscribers canceled their subscription. They said, "You must be crazy. We know that." The guy paid a really high price for saying what he said. And then in 1958, a book is published which gives the account, the answers that the Adventists gave to these questions under the title Questions on Doctrines, or the full title, Seventh-day Adventists Answer Questions on Their Doctrine. And the world was never the same. But Adventism did rethinking in 1956 to 58 because the leaders realized, we have been around for 100 years, people have no clue who we are. What we need at this point of time is a different approach. If we ignore them, we are not going to be known for who we truly are. We need to engage them. And of course, Hannon and Martin and Barnhouse help them to see, when you say Jesus had sinful nature, this is what the other Christians hear you say. They even had the discussion where they say, "Okay, what do you believe about Jesus Christ?" And they say, "Of course we believe that Jesus is divine, second person of divinity, of the Godhead." And they say, "And how come that downstairs in your bookshop you have these books by Uriah Smith, which says that he is a created being?" They say, take the book from the shelves and quickly republish a new one where it says that he's divine. Because, yes, some people in the history of Adventism believe that. So they have them to see how they are perceived by others, how to express things in theological language, that when you say he had sinful nature, this is what the other Christians hear you saying. Is that what you believe? And it's actually no. Yeah, this is what we believe. There was one man who was number one theologian for the last 50 years before that, but by the time the discussion starts, he's already retired, living in California, and his name is M. L. Andreessen. And he was a genius. But he is not invited to these discussions, and when the book is published, Questions on Doctrine, he reads that, and of course in the article that Barnhouse published, there was a paragraph which said, "We had discussions with the Adventist leaders, and they explained to us what the Adventists believe, and we have to say we were wrong, but they are genuine Christians who believe in righteousness by faith. They have all the doctrines of their classical Orthodox Christianity and should be accepted as genuine Christians and brothers and sisters." Now, of course, the article continues, like with any other group, there are a few wild-eyed fanatics on the margins of that movement, but that is in every Christian group. Now, of course, when the number one theologian read that he is a wild fanatic on the margins of the group, there is still discussion whether it was the Spirit of the Lord that descended mightily on him or a little demon that jumped into him. He starts writing his letters to the churches about this great betrayal in Adventism and the brethren who changed the writings of Ellen White and betrayed Adventism by having discussions with evangelicals. And the world was never the same. The rest is history. that after 58, when the book was published, and then 1964 comes with 120 years since the disappointment, Adventism enters a period of fragmentation. And so now you have people who say the solution is to go back. The greatest problem of Adventism was that discussion with evangelicals. That should have never taken place. Or you have the 1888 movement that says we need to go back to the way the doctor presented. And you have the quote from Ellen White, the light that the doctor brought was the light from heaven. The solution is to return back. To which let me say just one thing. The Bible starts in the garden, but ends in a city. Why? Because even God cannot go back. You have to go forward. And then there is a large group of young people who like the songs or like the pastor or have friends in the local Adventist church, or that's where they grew up, that's where their parents go, or that's the closest church. So they belong to Adventism, but they have no clue what Adventism stands for. They are cultural Adventists because that's where is their spiritual home. They have no understanding what Adventist theology represents. How is it different? And of course, then you have a mainstream Adventism, which basically says as long as you pay, pray, and obey, the administrators are going to bring you to the other side. Don't rock the boat. 7-7-7. As long as you pray 7 a.m., 7 p.m. for 7 days a week, the revival and reformation will come and will be safely there. And of course, then there are those who say that in every era, God's people have to change something, but don't change too much because it creates instability. Just change a little, and that's the solution. And of course, then there are those who say in 19th century, Americans seem the Catholics were the big enemies because with the Irish immigration, have you seen Titanic movie? Seeing them there, the third class downstairs? I mean, they were seen as a threat to the American religious freedom values. But we live in a world where terrorists don't care whether you are a Baptist, Catholic, or an Adventist. You are an enemy because you are a Christian. They are going to kill you. They don't distinguish between what denomination you are. So time has come for us not to emphasize how we are different, but to emphasize what we have in common. And so you have these different groups and currents in Adventism. These are the main five. I could speak for a long time, cover different, but these are the main five you can find in contemporary Adventism. Now, I have no idea where you see yourself. But I have some bad news and some good news for you. The bad news is the fact that you don't like the other type of Adventism does not mean that it's going to disappear. It's not going to disappear. These groups are here to stay. And the fact that you don't like it, it's not going to change it. The tragedy of contemporary Adventism is that we spend most of our money, effort, and energy on converting other Adventists to our type of Adventism. Because if Jesus was here, he surely would be like me. He surely would embrace my type of Adventism.
My Lord.
Yes. And so whether it's my version of the last day events, or my version of the human nature of Christ, or my version of health reform and the right way of eating, you name it, most energy, effort, and money in Adventism today is spent on converting other Adventists to my type of Adventism. And there is no future in that. The good news is, as long as Adventism remains a rethinking movement, and we engage one another in dialogue and are willing to learn from one another, we have a future.
Amen.
And the thing that we tell the pastors at New World, remember, when you come to the church, don't ally yourself with one group, with one interest group in your church, because you are a pastor of everybody. And you, Sam, are the president of all Adventists in the Southern Indian Conference. Can we create an umbrella where we can all live under one roof and benefit from the different perspectives that we all bring to the table? When I was younger, I thought this is a question of theology. And as long as we get the right theology, we'll strengthen everybody else. The older I get, the more I see now, this is a question of psychology. People are just wired differently. And they see what they see because of the filters. And they are like that in all aspects of their life. Some people just recognize only two colors, black and white. The first scanner that I bought in 1990 could distinguish between 256 shades of gray. Some people come, it's how you are wired. Here's the question. Can we find an umbrella so that all of us can live together under one roof? Because if yes, we have a future. If not, we are going to fragment. Only there are two of us left. And on a bad day, I bring my doubts about your orthodoxy. What I want to say is Adventism started as a rethinking movement. Adventism did rethinking a few times in its own history and did it well. Take 1888, take 1956. Adventism hasn't lost anything by doing this rethinking. Take, for example, the Trinity doctrine. In the first period, Trinity was unimportant. Actually, it was suspicious to many people. Why? Because the Catholics came up with it in the 3rd century. A Sunday-keeping, infant-baptizing, immortal soul-believing church. But there are few things they did right. Determine the canon, which books belong to the Bible, and determine the doctrine of Trinity. God can use the imperfect church to get a good result. Praise the Lord, where we would be, where we would be today. But then comes the Minneapolis, and suddenly the Trinity becomes important. Why? Because a proper understanding of who is the Savior is needed for the proper understanding of how we are saved. What about our times? Do you know what is the first major wish, desire of people in today's society? To spend more time in relationships with people that are important to them. Yet do you know how much time an average British father spends with his children?
6 minutes per week.
They know that it's important, but they can't deliver. Maybe you have come to the kingdom for times like this, because people say that relationships are the most important for them. You open the Bible, and on the very first page, you know what it says? In the beginning, God. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the abyss. And verse 3 says, and God said, let there be light. In the very first three verses of the Bible, you learn God exists as God the Father, He exists as God the Spirit, and He exists as God the Word, and God spoke, He said the Word, and John says, who was that Word that created everything? In the very first page of the Bible, you learn God exists in relationships. Community. God exists in community. Community is the most important thing in the universe. One day, everything that you see today is going to be no more. There's only one thing that will remain for all eternity. What? The community of redeemed. And the earthly family and the heavenly family will be one again. What's the most important in the Bible? The essence of ultimate reality is community. God exists as a community. Actually, the Bible says that when you die, you don't go to heaven in a one-seater plane. But Jesus says in John 14, I will come with a celestial jumbo jet, or now we say Airbus 380. You know, that's the big one that is the second floor, all the way, all the hall. It takes 800 to 1,000 people. I will take you all together because we are one community. What's the most important thing in the Bible? Community. God exists in community. We would not know that if it were not for the times that forced us to do, to open the Bible again and do the rethinking. Have we lost anything? Nothing. We just gained a new perspective. Nobody, none of us heard 25 years ago or 50 years ago preached from the pulpit. Okay, the same is true of judgment. Who needs the investigative judgment? Or they are going through the books to see who is going to be saved. There is a text in the Bible which says God knows those who are His. God doesn't need the investigative judgment. This four would say, what does it take 140 years? Is God short of secretarial help? And of course, the pioneers could not imagine the world in which we live, you know. I can take my card, you know, and put it into any ATM, punch my PIN, and it tells me what is the balance of my account. In real time, I press number 2 on my mobile, and it tells me exactly how much my account with O2 is. Now, pioneers could not imagine that. Of course, they have a picture. Somebody needs to flip through the books in order to know who's going to be saved. Then comes a different emphasis, different understanding, rethinking. Have you heard the sermons for the last 50 years? You got a friend in the court. Have you heard those sermons? Jesus is your friend. Who needs the investigative judgment? Oh, I need it in order to get to heaven. What about today? How do we understand? Do you know that the theologians now call it not the investigative judgment, but pre-advent demonstrative judgment? I have been living in this country for the last 15 years. You know what is the one cry that you can always hear in the parliament? Whatever happens in the British society, somebody's going to stand up and say, will the right honorable gentleman open the archive so that we can see what is the truth? How did we get into war in Iraq? What happened with this Leveson war? Whatever the problem, there's somebody going to say, we want open inquiry. We want to know the truth. And here is the Bible which says, God says, I have nothing to hide. Here are all the files. Have a look. Let's have an open inquiry. Mardecure says, maybe you came to the kingdom for times like this. You lose nothing with rethinking. You just get a new richness and perspective that helps you to see who God is and how what you believe is relevant for the society in which you live. And I'm sure that if we do the rethinking of the Second Coming after the Harald Camping fiasco, we have nothing to lose. Oh, have you noticed that the best tunes that we used to have, you know, us to Sabbath, the best books on keeping the Sabbath are not written by Seventh Adventists. In the last 50 years, the best books written on Sabbath keeping are written by the Adventists. Health, somebody else. 5 days stop smoking. NHS does a better job than we do. Second Coming. N.T. Wright wrote a book on heaven and hell that we should have written 50 years ago. All our best tunes are stolen by somebody else. If we do the rethinking, nothing is lost. All right, new events and new patterns of thinking always create a crisis of faith. Why do young people go through a crisis of faith? It's part of growing up. If you want to establish yourself as a different person than your parents, if your faith is supposed to be yours, not inherited, and remember, God has no grandchildren. God has only children. You have to be born into the kingdom yourself. You can't inherit faith from your parents. Every generation needs to come up with their own understanding. There is a reason for that rebellion. There is a reason for that pushing the boundaries, because that's the way to establish your identity. The wise book says that when the little child goes through the period of saying, no, no, you should support it. Say, I am going to eat your cake. No, it's my cake. Now, you can easily break that child, say, you are not going to say no to me. But you pay for that when they are 18, 19, because then they will not be able to say no to a boyfriend or a classmate that offers them drugs, to things they should say. Or you can use that period, that developmental period, when they go through the period and say no, 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 as a way of learning to say no to things that should be said no. There is a text in the New Testament, in Philippians, which says, yes, the grace of God has appeared to us, teaching us to say no. We should say yes to certain things and no to others. Okay. So there, you can't avoid a crisis of identity. New situations, new patterns of thinking always cause a crisis of faith. Remember? In the 19th century American village in East Coast America, there are two churches. There is a Presbyterian, which is the American speak for Calvinist, and there is Episcopalian, which is the American way of saying Anglican. And the question that everybody is asking is, where is the truth? Which is the true church? And then during a storm, a lightning hits one of the churches. And if the lightning hits the wooden church, what happens? And everybody says, now we know. God himself answered our question. And so Benjamin Franklin comes and says, guys, you need to put a piece of metal on the steeple of the church. You know what happens? People are going to fight the idea. Why? Because it creates a crisis of faith. Before, when the storm was coming, the church had a prayer meeting. Everybody was on their knees. Lord, let it not be our church. Please protect our church. Now they put a piece of metal on the roof, and the next time the lightning hits the church, it's not going to burn down. But if you don't do rethinking, praising God for the lightning conductor, you are going to go to your grave fighting the lightning conductor, thinking it's the devil's invention to lose your faith, but your grandchildren are going to believe it. They are going to laugh about it. If you don't do rethinking, you are going to die out like dinosaurs. You have no future. So, events, new patterns of thinking, new books, new directions in philosophy, in theology, in fashion, music, whatever, create always crises of faith. And now you have two options. Retreat into your bastion, your forest, or fortress, and condemn the whole world, which is gone crazy or bad. You can do rethinking. The only viable solution is not to fight penicillin, not to find the lightning conductor. Rethink your faith, then you have a future. Now, you can choose to fight penicillin, but your children are not going to believe it, and your grandchildren will laugh and say, ha ha ha, they have been children of their time. They are not going to survive. The only way to survive is rethinking. And you have a great advantage, because Adventism was born as a rethinking movement. Started as a rethinking. And because we have not got everything perfectly, we understand that. We are always willing to change. So, if we know today that smoking every cigarette shortens your life 7 minutes, and if somebody invents a cigarette tomorrow that will add to your life 7 minutes, what is Seventh-day Adventist Church going to say? Let's have a smoking seminar. Right? We are not going to say, oh, we always have a stop smoking seminar, because we say, oh, we have a rethinking movement. Now we are going to conduct the smoking seminars, because that's the way to add 7 minutes to your life. True? Okay, nice. So let me say something in ASI. If it's not like that in your local church, with people like you, who understand we are reinventing ourselves for the sake of our customers, let's say you and I are going to change that. Because you as business people understand that. Your business cannot survive unless you do rethinking. Unless you are reinventing yourself for the sake of your customers. You understand that. And that's why I never refuse an invitation to come and talk to ASI, because it's not a waste of time. You understand this. So if it's not like that, guys, let's promise before God, we are going to change it. We are going to become a rethinking movement. Once again. Adventism needed to do rethinking a few times in history, and so far, managed to do it well. So here's the fork in the road. Here are the two options. There is a future for Adventism. The greatest days of Adventism are still ahead of us. If we remain a rethinking community. And if we say, no, we are going to believe what we have always believed, you don't have to be a strong Adventist for that. There are plenty of other options. As Bill Hybels would say, I will hold the door for you so that it doesn't hit you on the way out. Many churches in the Chicago area that will gladly welcome you. Why would you be a member of a rethinking church? That's not your mentality. The future of Adventism depends on our ability to rethink our identity. The best days of Adventism are still ahead of us, as long as we remain a rethinking. That's how we have been born. That's where our future lies. And if there is an eschatological crisis coming to this world, we have something to offer. We have something to offer that Billy Graham and Bill Hybels and Rick Warren don't see because of our theology. But we need to retain or remain a rethinking movement.
Okay, that's all I have to say. Live for the sake of kingdom, be the best person you can be. Live the life that is worth living. Use the gifts that God gave you. Yes. Have the best company you can have. Go into business. Make your million. It's serving the Lord as much as being a co-porter, being a pastor. Just don't take the evaluation of the world as the final thing. Sometimes the things don't work out the way you expect. One day, God is going to vindicate before the whole of the universe, say, here are my children, I am proud of them. Here they are, Revelation 14:12. They are my sons, my daughters, I am proud of them. One day you will hear, well done, you did faithful servant. You need that mentality to run a business in 21st century England? You need that mentality to run a church. Multinational, multicultural church. All right. Do you know that Jesus had more to say about serving the poor than about prayer and being born again together? You have not learned this from Sabbath school. You need to read the Gospels. Is there any significance in that? You need to do some serious rethinking. In the parable of the Last Judgment, Jesus says that what is going to be the question that will be asked? Who else benefited from your religion? What did you do to the little ones, the marginalized? Because if you are the only one who benefited from your religion, you didn't serve God. You worshipped yourself. And as I said, you guys are the best positioned in the church. There are two types of people in the church, business people and educators, who have no problem to understand this. That's the nature of the game. And if you didn't learn it in Sabbath school, you learn it in life. So God bless you. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.